Anyway, so my name is Adam Cuppy. I am a principal at Zeal. We are a Rails consultancy. We specialize in test-driven development. Not anymore. and we are kind of an agile consultancy as well. So today the focus of the talk is to talk about RSpec design patterns. So just to clarify the expectation for today so that, again, it's clear, this is not going to be a workshop on what you should be testing. Okay, so this is, I know, get out. I'm just kidding. Okay, although I'm going to cover a few of those things, this workshop is specifically surrounding how you should structure a test. Okay, and the primary goals of structuring the test are so that it can be extendable, that it's relatively dry, and that you're using the conventions that RSpec has established for you to use. Most people fit inside this, or when they're writing their tests, they only use the handful of things, right? They use describe blocks. Well, they have to do at least that, you know, and then beyond that point, they probably use it. Many of you probably are familiar with let, or even before and after blocks, right? But before we get going, I want to just tell you guys of this. So our consultancy puts on a workshop and training. Last year, we had Kent Beck, who is one of the first signatories of the Agile Manifesto. He helps co-organize the event with us. And then last year, we also had Ryan Bates facilitate the workshop with us as well. Granted, he's on hiatus now, but very cool. So this is a workshop where if you want to learn anything more, this is going to be the best place to do it. If you go to roguerails.com and you add your email address in, that's all you got to do. We're going to do a very, very smoking sweet discount for everybody here at RailsConf. But being that that's the primary website, it's going to go away and go down. So it's just roguerails.com. Very well worth it. I highly encourage it because I want your money. Southern Oregon. Yeah. Beautiful Southern Oregon. Yeah. See, here's how you want to do it. Let me just tell you, okay, just between you, me, and the wall and the interwebs. You're going to show up a few days early. You're going to go hiking in the fields. You're going to go down, ride a river of some kind. You're going to have a good time. You're going to come down, learn a little bit of code, and go home and say you learned something, okay? That's how this is going to go down. Okay, so again, this is about design patterns. So what we're going to, the way this is going to be structured is that I'm going to talk through, kind of illustrate what a pattern is, okay, in terms of an RSpec design pattern. And then I'm going to show you a few examples, and then I'm going to actually walk through implementing the pattern, okay? Again, this is a live coding workshop, so even though I've got a handful of slides to show, they're not going to be the primary use. If you have questions, what I'm going to ask that you do is just simply, like, hold on to it, and then I'm going to have an opportunity where I'm like, okay, do you have any questions about this? Because what we have found in the past is that a lot of either questions get answered, or what happens is there's a time and a place where, you know, you're kind of like working as a collective, okay? Another thing that's very much going to happen during this is you're going to buddy up. We actually implement pair programming a majority of the time, so we're big fans of kind of the collective learning process. If you're not comfortable with that, I got mints, okay? So, again, kind of get used to the idea, right? Are there any preliminary questions? Very good. So what I first want to do is I want to gauge and get a sense of where everybody is in their RSpec and or testing knowledge. Okay, so on a scale from 0 to 5, 0 being I have never written a test before, so I am an absolute newbie, to 5 being I could be standing here. That's right, I put myself in the 5 category. Give me a sense. I want you to raise your hand if you would consider yourself a 0, like you've never written a test before. It's okay. It's cool. Okay? Never written a test before. Okay. You're a 1. You've written a couple of tests, but you really don't have a strong sense for the structure of them. You get the convention. Okay. Give me a 2. You've maybe written them on an app of yourself, you know, for yourself, but, you know, you don't know what a good practice is. You just, it's ad hoc. Okay. How about a 3? Halfway there, you'd consider yourself, you know, you're not a newbie anymore. You have a strong sense of the components. How about a 4? Oh, very good. Hello, nemesis. Okay, and and give me a 5. Excellent. Let's fight in the corner. Very good. Okay, so this is going to be good for everybody. Now, again, how this is going to work is I am going to cover some of the basic components of it, but at the end of the day, trust me, we're going to get to some components that are a little bit more comprehensive. Wow. Okay, so let's take a real quick break here. Unfortunately, all of those of you who just arrived, you did not appear in the group selfie, but that's okay. We are going to do another one. Exactly. Thank you very much. I will be tattooing it onto my arm when we're done. Okay, very good. So again, the focus of this is to talk specifically to how we write tests, not what we are testing, although I'm going to hit on a couple of those points because they kind of go hand in hand a little bit. I would highly recommend, I'm a big fan of Gary Bernhardt and Sandy Metz, who speak a lot to what to be testing. So if you are looking for more information on that, those are two resources that I highly encourage because they do a really phenomenal job at identifying what matters. Ranging from experience, basically from 0 to 5, five being very, you know, highly competent. This is, you know, old hat for me. I get how this RSpec and structure works. I'm gonna be tackling pretty much the entire range, but we're primarily going to be focusing on the 2 to 5 portion of it. Actually, probably the 2 to 4. When we get into the 5, if we have enough time, I'll go through some of like the really kind of really strong patterns that you can utilize to really dry up your tests, but we'll get there when we get there, okay? So the first thing that I want to talk to is controlling your values with let. Now, again, we're like on the 2-ish range here, okay? So some of the core functionality that RSpec has to offer is that, you know, we can easily run into problems where we have got, like, here's an example test that we're going to start with, right? And we're going to work from this baseline example. Okay, so just simply to put it, to put some context into it. So this here is just, you know, a simple user model, right? We've got a just basic Rails application, user model. You know, we're not using devise or anything like that. You know, I don't want to get too complex here. You know, don't criticize the way in which I wrote this code. This is just, you know, a basic, simple example. Right, you know, so as you can see, we've got like 26 lines of code total, you know, not a whole lot. We're extending from active record base. We're using a couple of validators. You know, we have some, you know, just kind of simple functionality in here to, you know, to do just some basic action authentication. You know, if you notice, we've got a first name, a middle name, and a last name. And then down on line 19, we've got a new method where we're actually going to concatenate them all together and make a full name, okay? Again, pretty simple. Oh, yeah, can we? Sure. If someone knows how to do that, right on.
Can we just reprogram the RSpec?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, one set.
Is there something we're supposed to download?
Not yet. Yeah, don't worry about it. There is, but not yet. Okay, so again, what we've got here is we've got just a basic... Oh, big win. Maybe we can do the same issue. The knowledgeable one, make do happen. Not yet. Now I am in darkness. Total darkness. Okay. Is that all right? Okay, cool. Yes. Not good? Well, okay, so we'll come back. Okay, so so we're just talking that we've got just a basic model here. We've got a full name method that's just gonna concatenate the first, middle, and last names together. And then we've got this kind of permissions collection that's happening down on line 23 that just simply is gonna collect an array of permissions, whatever those are gonna mean eventually, right? Again, let's not, you know, we don't need to worry too much about this code here. Just give a sense of context, right? Simple 26 lines. Here is an example spec that is really common, okay? Really, really common, right? So what we have here is, you know, just looking at the top of the file, we're going to include the spec helper. Our spec helper, if you're not familiar with that in a Rails application or just any kind of any test suite, is going to do a lot of our setup for us of the suite itself, you know, include any pertinent libraries and, you know, things of that nature. And then, you know, just kind of reading through from the top, you know, we're going to describe user accounts, right? We're going to start there. And then, you know, now we're going to get into where we want to start to do a little bit more description of our validations, right? And so, you know, we're going to say, yeah, so we're going to describe user accounts. And, you know, then we're going to describe the length of the first name, right? This all seems to make sense, right? I mean, we're describing these two things. Yeah, there's no issues here, right? And then we're going to put in our first set of assertions, and we're going to say that it should not be super long, right? I mean, this all makes sense, right? There's no issues with any of this, right? No problems anywhere, right? And so inside of line six, between line six and nine, you know, we're going to set up a simple user model, right? Who doesn't do that, right? We're going to do this, and we're going to say, yeah, we want a new user, and then our first name is going to be really, 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 really super, super, super long first name that is crazy long. Right? So, you know, so this is going to effectively, what we're trying to do is we're trying to test basically line five, right? So we want to know that that the validation of first name, that it's present, and that it's a length between 2 and 50, right? And again, in our example here, now, I know there's matchers for this, but bear with me, is that we're gonna test this basic assertion, right? On line 8 there, now this is the actual test itself, and we're going to use, we don't believe in the expect syntax yet. That doesn't mean anything to us. That is a dead language. Just kidding. So we're just, you know, we're going to say if, you know, user valid, and it's going to return true or false, and then we're going to say, but it should not equal true, right? Okay. So we're going to jump over here for a second, and we're going to say yes. We're going to say bundle exec. Spec models user spec. We're gonna run it like the speed of light, okay? And actually, just for this example, we'll just run line six, okay? Like the speed of light. Okay, so we've got one example and no failures, right? Or at least when we run line six, right? So on the surface, this seems to work well. Does anyone see a problem with this yet? What?
He said just one.
Just one, that's right. Yeah. Does anyone see the inherent challenge of this? So what are we testing for a second here? We're testing that valid is what? Anybody know? Somebody with a five, tell me, what are we testing? Valid is what? Not true. Perfect. We are testing that user valid is not true, right? Okay, so again, let's take a look back at our code, right? Okay, so here we are with our code. Okay? So we're looking at line 5, right? What is one component of this validation? We are testing for what? Very good. Okay, so that it exists, right? The second component is that we're testing that the minimum length is what? The maximum length is, right, so we have those two validations, right? Okay, so that's all fine and dandy. Now let's give it a whirl, whoops. Okay, so going back to this spec right here, let's look at this again and go, okay, so we're testing that valid should not be true, right? Okay, so let's find something out real quick. So our assertion is between 2 and 50 characters, right? Okay, so we'll just comment this out for a second, all right? And we're going to say user, we're going to write it again, user, and we're going to test that first name is between 2 and 50 characters, right? Right? So this is going to pass, right? So our test is now going to effectively be broken. Is that correct? Okay, so let's run it again and find out what happens. Do it with me, come on. Now, can anybody raise their hand and tell me why? Why is it continuing to pass? The other validations are getting it to fail, right? So the problem is that we've got a couple of issues with this test from basically the beginning, right? The issue that we have is that we're trying to, in this point right here, we're trying to test a single field, a single attribute, right? But the problem is that we have other validations, right? So when we're trying to test valid is not true, the issue that we're running into pretty much right away is that our test is failing, we're getting a false positive, right? This is a problem, right? So okay, so now you can go to the repository, now that I'm going to lose your attention here for a moment. So if you want to go to it, we created a little thing on codingzeal.com/skinny. And by all means, please fork that puppy, start, whatever you like. It's just a basic Rails app. There's nothing special to it whatsoever. There's going to be a couple of examples, like a single model and a few specs. Again, no big deal. No real configuration. You can run bundle, all that sort of stuff. Raise your hand once the internets have crashed. Internets have crashed. Okay, I can't fix them. I'm just raise your hand that they've crashed. Okay. So basically, the format of this is that I'm going to go through a handful of these examples. I'm going to illustrate the kind of core principle, and then I'm going to let you guys go at it. If you've got your own code that you're working with, I can even recommend a couple of open source projects that are awesome to refactor. I highly recommend that you do that because it's kind of a great way to kind of experiment with that. One of the projects that needs a little bit of help, and I say that in a really positive light, is CanCan. I think there's like CanCan community. There's a lot of tests in here that could really benefit pretty heavily from some of this work. So if you want to experiment with that one or this project, by all means, please do. But yeah, we'll go from there. So Skinny is just it's a CMS that is skinny, that has nothing in it, basically. Okay. That's a good point. I don't know. Maybe. Anybody have a USB stick poking around that they could put it on there?
Can you set the file share on your
machine? No. This is a room of people who would destroy my show. Just kidding. Okay. So one of the core principles that we're going to talk to here for a second is, what is it? So we're going to start with this idea. Okay. And this is function from the pattern of a minimum valid object, an MVO, okay? And here is the principle to that. A minimum valid object is going to be from the top of my spec permutating through the remainder of it. So cascading down the list, I will always know that at the very top layer of my spec, the object, the subject that I'm working with is valid, right? So then as I work through my spec, as I begin to add more assertions to it, as I add more tests, all I have to do is mutate the validity of the object and test against that, one piece at a time, okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Right? Okay, so this is a core component to a solid test suite. There's a lot of benefits to starting this way. Now, there is a gem that is really fantastic that is based on these principles. How many of you have you heard of Factory Girl? Okay. Factory Girl is a really, really useful tool, but the where it goes wrong, where people tend to use it poorly, is that they forget that a factory should only represent, in its base form, it should only represent the minimum requirements of a valid object. That's it. Okay? Once you start to add in things to that object that make it that are optional, then what happens is you're playing with the validity of the object in a way that you can't have control over when you're running in your test. You don't have confidence any longer. Okay? So so looking back at the code, right? So the first thing that we're gonna wanna do is we're gonna wanna build up our minimum valid object. Okay. So let's just start with a subject. Who is not familiar with what a subject is? Okay, so basically the subject is the entity that your tests will be working against, right? The subject of the test, right? You can change this whenever you like, but the pattern is that you're going to start with a subject, right? Now,
you can also
Mooch. So starting from the top here, so there's a couple of changes that we're going to make, and RSpec is pretty cool in a couple of ways because it will actually imply a subject for you if you don't declare it, if you do something like that, okay? So RSpec is pretty darn intelligent, as are many of the testing frameworks, that in the describe block here, if I specify an actual object, see how it's not quoted, right, but the actual class itself, what RSpec is going to automatically do is it's going to set up this. It's going to effectively run this from the beginning. It's the equivalent, right? It's going to create just a new instance, and it's going to pass nothing into it, right? That is something that's all fine and dandy. My personal preference is that I like to explicitly set what the subject is. Because, again, we're talking about developer happiness to a large extent. And as on a dev team, you know, we might have 6, 7, 8 people working on a project at any given point, and they all have to have a sense for what's going on, right? Now, if we follow this common pattern here, right, and which we do to a large extent, and just say that the top describe is always going to have a class passed into it, then it's actually, that's a convention that's pretty ubiquitous with the testing methodologies, while at the same time is, if your minimum valid object is in fact not this, right, then you already have run into issues, right? Because what did I say before? You want to start with what? Minimum valid object, right? So if that isn't valid, in my opinion, that's a no-go, right? You want to start from a minimum valid object, right? So what I do is, even though I put the describe in here, I am still going to create my minimum valid object. So looking back at our code here, we're going to start with the first validation, which is that it has to have a what? First name, right? All right, we're going to say it's Jimmy, okay? And it says it has to be between 2 and 50 characters, which we're good. Does it have to have a minimum name? Does it have to have a middle name? No. How about a last name? Okay, so we're going to say a last name is Jimmy Johnny, okay? All right. Does it have to have an email address? Okay. How about a password? Okay, so we're gonna say password. Oh, dang it, I just used my password. Wait, there, okay. God, I hate when I do that. Hope this isn't on the interwebs. Okay, oh, sorry, I jumped ahead. What also does it need with a password? Confirmation, yes it does, okay. All right, so we're going to say that again. Okay, so password one. Let's do some word wrapping. Okay. Maybe we'll do it a little bit bigger than that. Yeah, a little gooder. Much gooder. Okay, so our subject from the get-go, okay, is going to be a minimum valid object, right? Now, for those of you who are not totally familiar with subject, from this point forward, you can refer to it as subject. So just as an example down here, let me say I'm going to, should have a first name, right? So again, I'm gonna use should right now, but we'll get into expect. I do know that it exists, okay? So we're gonna say subject, first name, oh wait, yeah, first name, right? I can pull against the subject itself by just calling subject. However, what you can also do is, this is a method just like anything else, right? So you can actually pass in what this object would be, right? So I can, at this point, I can also say, look, I'm gonna do it just for all of you. Oh, whoops. Right. First name to B. What to be a kind, whatever. Right. Okay, so I can also call it explicitly by, through a name, right? Basically a method that it's dynamically creating in the context of the spec itself, okay? Basic stuff, right? This is like, we're getting into the, we're like a level one, all right? Level one, maybe verging on two. Okay, so again, we're going to start from a minimum valid object, right? So now what we can do inside of our specs is we can start to use this subject entity and we can assert against it, right? So again, we're going to start to refactor this a little bit because we want this to be a little bit cleaner. And I'm going to get into some other practices here in a moment, right? So looking at line 9 right here, right? So we're going to eventually replace this object right here, right, with our new subject, right? This is what we're going to do. But we kind of have a little bit of a challenge, and it's like, well, okay, but we are declaring first name up here, but I want to make sure that it's not super long. So how am I going to pass in this string and replace it with this item up here, right? Okay, so here's what commonly happens is oftentimes you'll see something like this. And we're going to say user first name is now equal to this guy, right? And now we're going to say user, right? And then we can now assert against it, right? And we're going to say, okay, so now user, oh wait, right? So now user, right? Because we're calling it down here, right? Does that make sense? Now we can say user should be true or should not be valid, right? Does that make sense? Okay. But we don't want to do this, okay? And I'll tell you why. So actually, well, let's just run our test real quick and see where we get. We'll run line 12. Still, we're passing, right? Okay. But here's the problem, right? A couple of problems. Problem number one is that we still have the issue we had before, right? So even though we've done a little bit of a refactoring here, the problem is that we haven't changed the false positive issue, right? We still have this problem of, you know, we're still testing the validity in its inverse, right? We're saying that valid, which should be true, should not, which means it is not, be true, right? 101, right? I mean, we've got this really kind of wonky assertion in here. So again, we visually know that this is the problem. We've kind of addressed this by refactoring some of this code, but we actually haven't eliminated this testing problem, right? So here's the next principle. And I'm going to jump around a little bit. And that is, what do I have a thing in here? Oh, actually, we'll start with this guy, right? So just as an example, let's look at this simple expectation, right? And then we say object, valid, should not be true, right? Okay. Now here's the problem with this, is that we're saying that valid, which we're expecting to turn true, should not, which we're expecting it to invert that, should be true. Does that make sense to anybody? Right? But it makes sense when you're writing it. You're like, yeah, unless it's not true, it should be not false. Okay. So then if we put it in the expect syntax, it's going to look something like this, right? It expects object not to be valid, right? Makes a little bit more sense, right? How about that? Is that a little better? Okay. Here's the principle. Test to true, right? You want to test to true. That's what you should be doing. Don't test to false. Test to true. Because if you're functioning from the concept of a minimum valid product, or minimum valid object, excuse me, MVP, MVO, minimum valid object, then you know from the beginning that what you're always testing to is you're always testing to a true state. If it's valid, if it's invalid, the principle is I'm going to test to true, assert to true. That's what I'm trying to determine, right? So again, from a developer happiness standpoint, it gets you to the, now again, we haven't actually solved our problem yet. We haven't done it yet. But what we are doing at this point is we're making it something that is readable and understandable so that we can easily see our issue, right? We can easily see that, oh, I'm expecting the object to be invalid. Well, it's invalid for many reasons. What makes it valid, right? So this is where the expect syntax, a lot of people complain about the expect syntax because it's like one of these things where they're like, you know, now I have to write all this stuff because I used to be able to, you know, make it look like, I used to be able to like make it look a little bit cooler and whatever. No good, right? So always assert to true, a true state, right? Now in our example, right, going back to our example, there we are, okay. The simple way to invert this in a way that we are testing to true would be to just invert it, right? So we're going to say user to be valid. Right? So if we go back to our test and we run it again, let me just make sure we're on the same line. Was there a comment? Well, so we're testing to be what? Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. Right. I need at least two more hecklers in the room. Invalid. Invalids. Right? Okay. So we're testing to true, right? Okay, so again, the issue here, though, is that we actually still haven't solved our problem. We're still working from invalid, right? We still have the same issues that we had before. So now we're going to go through a process of refactoring this out so that we can actually be true. We can be testing. We can run an assertion that would be what I wrote before, which is this, right? We ultimately want to assert that our expectation is going to be that the user will always be valid. So we're going to manipulate the first name, right? We're going to manipulate the first name and test that it's invalid, right? But then we want to also go back to the beginning and test that it's valid. So one way that we could do it is we could actually include it up here, right? And oftentimes when I'm putting together tests, I will do this, but I generally will eliminate them as well. I'll write this temporarily just so that I can make sure it's a little bit of a sanity check, and I don't think it's a bad practice at all, right? So let's see if this is still the case. Okay. We forgot our email address, didn't we?
But that's not, I thought we said it was optional. Yeah.
Say again?
I thought we said it was optional. Yeah.
Let's find out. Of course I did. Let's check our code here real quick. No, it's not optional. Yeah, I didn't do this. Right? So we are actually testing, our test is accurate. Now again, this is not a very TDD approach, right? Workshoppy, whatever. That there?
No, the email. Oh, I see. So if it checks format, it has to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it calls thank you.
Right. Right.
You'll notice that we flood the phone.
Yeah. Okay, so we're getting a little closer, right? We're getting just a little closer to where we should be here. Okay, so again, we're working from a minimum valid object. Now, the next principle that we want to function from is, so if we kind of continue to look through our code here for a moment, we've got this, we have similar kind of structure, right? So we're trying to dry things up more and more and more, right? And we want to get to the point where we can eliminate Sublime to Vim, how much I love you. So where we can start to eliminate some of this duplication, right? The inherent duplication of this, right? So here's the next principle that I want to illustrate. And that is this guy. It's controlling your values with let, right? So the next principle is that you never, there's a law. No, just kidding, okay. This is the law of controlling your values, the law of Adam, right? So the next pattern is, and kind of core principle to this is control all of your values with let. Okay, all of them. Here's what this means. So in this example up here, right, we're building this user object right here with a bunch of attributes on it, right? And we're passing in string values that represent all of these various states, or these various values for these different attributes. Down here in this describe block on line 10, the way that we're manipulating the value of first name on user is that we're having to call the user object. We're then having to access the first name, and then we're going to add in a new value to it, and we're going to come down here and we're going to assert its validity, right? Well, if you control all of your values using lets, you can actually roll values over, right? So as they cascade, as your tests cascade through its context and its describes, the lets are going to override one another, right? And allowing you to create permutations on the same value. So I'll show you how this gets done, right? So first thing we're going to do is we're going to create a let that represents first in caps lock, first name, okay? And we're going to put our value into here, right? We've got Johnny. I'm going to publish this code, yeah.
The slides.
Oh, I can, sure. Well, if you look at the repository, it's actually in the README.
Okay,
yeah, sure. I wrote it in German, but I'm just kidding. But this is really a training exercise. Only the smart survive. No, I'm just kidding. All right, and one more. Okay. As a side note, I've seen this done many times before where when you're dealing with, again, I'm going to acknowledge there are matchers for this that I think they're Thoughtbot shoulda matchers that are fantastic for testing validations. So setting that aside, there's a lot of gem support for this, and I guess that's the learning experience here. But in this example, we're going to do this a little bit more our own way. Okay. Say that again. The scope of the let is to the describe. Yeah, this describe.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. It's in the context of this describe block or example block. Yeah. So one, as a side note, I've seen this done before. Not a fan. Okay. Anybody know why? There you go. Exactly. Yeah. Simple principle, right? So in terms of your let, right? It's because how you access a let, for those who don't know, is it's treated just like a method, right? I'll get into this a little bit later, but so what's going to happen is when password confirmation gets called, right, it's going to then call on the let up here and return its value, right? So what that implies is that if I change one, I'm going to end up changing both, right? If I change the first one, and it's going to automatically be changing the second one. Here's why it's not a good practice, specifically in the context of password confirmation, is you want you should never have an example in your application where you have for password confirmation where you're duplicating another value for the confirmation. It should be two individual values that are added in. So in regards to this specifically, password and password confirmation, definitely never do it, because I very possibly am going to also get an inaccurate value there, right? Okay, and then up here in my object, I'm just going to go through and replace these. Where is the... So these are not, they're not automatically run, and this is going to get into another principle I'm going to show you here in a second. Yeah, you can order these however you like. Personal preference, but it is preference, is to put the subject to the very top, right? Yeah. And we'll get into instance variables over using lets here in a second. Because RSpec has a lot of support for implying what the subject will be. So if you can do that, you can use let. But in terms of the conventions that are defined by RSpec and a lot of the testing frameworks, is that subject is the thing we're testing against. Lets and things like it are to control value state, right? Clarity. Yep, absolutely. Yeah. And that's the big reason why I am not, if you can explicitly say this is my subject, even though we know that RSpec is going to help us out and it's going to create the other version of this, right? Again, RSpec's going to do this by default. I don't. I actually declare it myself, right? Just to make sure that it's really, really clear exactly what we're testing. Okay. So basically, so what we've done here, and yeah, it's a few more lines of code, I get that, right, is that we're controlling our values entirely through let. What this allows us to do is we can now replace this entire block with, before I replace it. So I don't have to write it again. So I can replace it with that. So what's going to happen is in the context of the example at the very top layer right here, okay, it's going to use the first name value from line 6, right, in this let. But when it jumps into this describe to check the length of the first name, this let value here on line 15 is going to override the one above it. So when the subject gets built, it's going to use the let from the second example, right? Again, we're like RSpec 2, RSpec-ish 3 right now, okay? In terms of, kind of, does that make sense? Right? But again, we're always working from a valid state. So here's the thing. Again, if the convention is work from a minimum valid product, which means that what is this going to do?
Just change first name,
and it's going to mean that it's just simply going to invert the object, or invert the validity of the object. It's that simple, right? So now what has happened in terms of, we're talking developer happiness here, and pattern is, I have an assertion that I know will be true. So again, we're always asserting against true. So if I run this expectation, it's going to return true. I know everything beyond this point. I can know that if it goes invalid, what has been affected is what I have changed. Does that make sense? Right? Core principle, always work from a minimum valid object, right? And again, we can continue to go down this path. So down here in this example, right? So we're going to do a little bit of changing here. Raise your hand if you're familiar with what the difference or the usage difference of a describe block versus a context block is. Okay? Principle number next is this guy. Permutations using context. Okay? So again, one of the challenges that we have when we're writing specs is like, we've got all these variations, right? I mean, like, going back to our code again, right? Like, going back to our code, we've got multiple things that could take this object out of valid, right? And into an invalid state. We've got many permutations, like, what if the first name's too short and the last name's too long? Right? Do we need to test that now too? And the common and what most people do is they do, right? They're going to come in here and they're going to say, "Okay, I'm going to run a test that is, I'm just going to come down here and say it has a really long first name and a really short last name." Right? Anyone ever seen this before? Yeah, and then what they do is they do something really smart, and they do something like, okay, so I'm gonna now put two of them in here, right? So user first name, right? Or actually, this is my favorite. Errors to include, and then they like pass in first name too short, or something along these lines, right? Have you ever seen this before, right? Let me ask you a question using this as an example. What are you actually testing right now? This is a Sandy Met sort of thing. What are you testing? Are you testing your code or are you testing Rails? Right. So, huh?
That and you're testing that the error message is still...
Right, and that the error message means this. So if I go back and I decide to change my error message to be something like, "You're that stupid, why did you put that in?" Right, or something like that.
Really?
You're like, really? WTF, dog. I mean, like, if I was to change it to that, now my test is going to break, right? So this is no good, right? So instead, again, what we're doing here is we're saying I'm going to control the permutation, and where context come in is now I can wrap this in a new context. And again, context, by definition, is the context of the object at this point. So when first name is too long. Right? So now, when I run this, let's run it, see what happens. So we'll do, let's do line 14, shall we? Let's see if I have any syntax errors. Anybody? Okay, and actually we'll do... I don't know if you saw it, there's some really awesome formatters out there now. Okay, so if we read this, okay, it gives us a little bit more information. So all that I did, if you didn't notice, is I just threw in a different format so that it outputs a little differently. And normally I'll work from a dots, like just seeing the dots because it's easier to read. But again, looking at this from developer happiness, what we've got here is we're like, okay, user. And user, we're going to describe the length of the first name, and it should not be super short, that it exists, shouldn't have weird characters. But we can also see, this is what RSpec is going to do for us, is it's going to add in a new context that is, when the first name is too long, it should not be super long, right? Or actually, what would be better, to make this a little bit more readable for the world. Right? So now we can take advantage of RSpec's beauty, and we can say, okay, the user, when the first name is too long, it should be invalid. Right?
Yeah.
Pretty easy to read, pretty easy to understand. Yes?
Sweet.
Wait,
so context is basically just for pretty print?
No. Yeah. So contexts are similar to describes in the sense that they set up an example, a scenario, in which certain things are true. Right? So in the context, and the convention when writing or filling in the description of a context, the convention that generally is used is that the context is going to start with when or with or as or something that's defining a behavior or state, specifically a state. Like, again, like when the first name is too long, now I'm going to set it up, right? I'm going to overwrite first name, and I'm going to say it expects user to be invalid, right? Describes are treated very similarly. However, they are setting up more of a the easiest way to understand it is it just sets up a larger container of description, right? So actually what I would do, and again, it's just a naming thing, is I actually will change the describe blocks to represent either the attribute and or the method that I'm testing, right? So again, when I'm reading it, because, right, so it's easier for me to get a sense of what's going on. To a large extent, if your tests are written well, right, structured well, you can actually use them as documentation to a large extent, right? If they feel and appear like documentation, and one of the smells that we'll have is like you run the test suite in a nested format like this so you can see it all. And if it's just like, wow, this is a crazy novel I can't read, then that's a smell that my test has got some issues in it, right? Because it should be able to describe the things that are going on really pretty easily. Okay? Any other questions about that? No? Okay. So continuing down the refactor path here, right, and using let's to do it, right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to say a new context, and we're going to say when too short. And we'll actually change this, when too long, when too short. Right, and we're going to add a new let, first name. Right, we're going to take our value here. Don't worry, for all these, okay, right? So now we're gonna test when it's too long, we're gonna test when it's too short. Oh, whoops, I actually need to make some changes. Okay, pretty simple, right? Now here's the great thing is we're setting up a pattern that is really extendable, right? So again, and these layer on top of one another, if we know that are at the top layer, we're always dealing with a valid object, then we don't have to hunt through the code to figure out what state of the object is that we're working with. Like, we don't have to go, my subject is this, but I actually don't know what my subject really is. I don't know what state it's in. I don't know what condition it's in. I don't know whether or not my test is actually going to be able to assert different values on one another. Like, I have no idea. But if I continue down this path, I'm like, okay, well, now I'm going to come over here and I'm going to say, what's another validation we could throw on first name? Anybody? We could say, we could just say, we won't write the code. We'll TDD this a little bit. Well. Because TDD is actually the secret to existence as a developer. My whole world got screwed up. Okay, when it includes the last name. Right? And now I don't have to read everything above it. I can go, oh, okay, so first name is going to be Jimmy. And last name is going to be Jimmy. It expect user to be invalid.
Still working under this describe context of first name, though, right?
Correct. Yeah. It is, no, I know. So I could now add in a validation if I said, for example, like if I wanted to implement. Okay, so here, we'll just run it, and you can kind of see what it's going to do. It's going to, what are we at, 28? So it's going to fail. And the reason why it's going to fail is we just haven't implemented yet. We haven't implemented the functionality to test the two. So if basic.
It was actually the one above, though, something about the
short one.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's not too short. All right. So we'll do that, right? You're right. Good catch. Oh, but I'm not writing, I'm not writing the whole thing here. 14. Just make it easier on everybody's life. What did I do wrong, people? Anybody see it?
That was fine.
Oh, yeah, okay. Oh, yeah, it should be invalid. Yeah, right. Yeah, thank you. So in our second example, this would be where we would now go implement our code. But again, if I'm controlling all my values with let, right, I always know that I'm setting things up properly, right? And I also know that I can just continue to extend this, right? I can continue to move down the path and change values on this, right? Any questions to that? Mm-hmm.
Is there any reason why you don't have one
referred to the other here? No, actually. But a general practice, you could do that if you wanted to confirm that a little bit more, absolutely. This would be probably an example where that would make sense to do that, because this is one where you're testing that the two are identical, yeah? Or at least in terms of your setup. Good question. Any other questions regarding this? Sir? Mixing and matching the context?
Look, you got line 28 is a context syntax that you're switching to, and 35 is the it stuff that you started with.
Yeah, so if I was to continue down the refactor story, I would refactor all of these. So I'm going to replace, I would go through and I would replace these individually.
Okay.
Right? So when the presence. And now I've replaced this guy. Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah. So I'm mixing them just for the sake of that we haven't gone through entirely and entirely replaced them. Yeah, absolutely. And so that's part of the challenge, actually, is that because they're compatible, it's easy to write. It's easy to get into the process of writing it one way or over another. Because here's the other thing, and this is one of the complaints that I've heard oftentimes is, whoa, you just added like five lines of code. I get that. But in my production code, where I'm really concerned about things like that for, you know, performance reasons, right? When it comes to the specs, I'm willing to make sacrifices like that so that it's easy to read, right? Easier to read, right? You know, there's a lot of talk, obviously, about the performance of spec, right? You know, like how fast your test suite's going to run. Is this going to be faster than that? You know, things along those lines. And that's all valid if that's your primary concern. Here's the thing that I've experienced a lot of, which is the function of a test is to assert what is and is not correct, right? That is the function of the test, right? So if that is not, so if as a developer and as an engineer, I do not have the healthy enough degree of, that I'm not as confident about that being the case, then my test suite actually becomes less and less relevant to me, right? I'm going to end up doing a little bit more click-through testing, right? But this is a way that I can do that and control this, right? So, yes? Mm-hmm.
You should, right?
Specify what is.
Like when is less than 2 or more than 50.
Mm-hmm.
That ties with the specific.
Yeah, so
that you want.
Did everybody catch that question, comment? Okay, no. Basically what he's pointing out is he's like, okay, so looking at the code, looking at the context right here, right? What we're saying is when it's too short, what does too short mean? Right? He's saying, like, should I be more descriptive about whether or not what too short implies, right? Should I say it's between 2 and 50? It's less than 2, actually. Or it's too long, it's over 50. And the answer to that is actually a little dynamic, right? So here is, it's a good default to put it in there. Here's where it actually becomes a pain in the rear, is if you go, if I all of a sudden want to go over here and say, two characters or three characters or less is too short, right? The only change I have to make is there, right? And everything now too short becomes implied by my code, right? It's easier to update that. However, my test still isn't telling me that, right? It's not telling me that it's the number three is the one that matters. Yeah. And so in that regard, clarity is king. Here's what I would say would be the rule of thumb, and that is that if you get into a situation where you're doing something like this, you're like, this is going to be an exaggerated example. So when the name has a that in it and is less than 3 and has a dog icon on it. Right? What's happening at this point is you're like, okay, now I don't have to just change my test. I actually now have to go through and figure out what the heck is what, right? And that becomes a little bit, from a maintenance standpoint, a little bit of a challenge. But at the end of the day is I want my test to be very clear as to what the heck is going on. So to your point, yes, I probably would put in that it is under 2 or it is over 50. Yeah, good question. Any other questions out there in the... the world now?
Do you have time for one more? I use the style, but I find that I have a problem sometimes with readability because when I'm right down in maybe the fifth indent, I sometimes have to refer all the way right to the top to understand what I've done.
Yes.
And go down there.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way of getting around that? I mean, it reminds me of that sort of
yes.
Chinese talk. You know,
you're talking about the shape, the deepness,
yeah.
You get down in an S.
You've got to go all the way up to figure out, you know, what is it, what's my state?
Yes, there is. You're in luck today. Thank you. I'll give you $20 later. Okay, so let's go back to our different examples, right? I'm going to get to that here in a second, actually. There's a couple other points that I want to make, right? One of them is this, and that is be descriptive. How many of you have seen something like that? Raise your hand if you've ever put a number in to represent which object we're talking about here. Do it. Raise your hand. We're all friends here. Okay. So then what happens is you have something like that, right? The first one's passing, the second one's not passing, and you're looking at this and you're like, Well, yeah, of course, because user two's invalid, dog. You're like, cool. And my comment to that is, what about it is invalid, right? Now, let me ask you a question. What if we were to do something like this, right? And now we got that. One person in the audience, raise your hand if you have a sense of what is relating to the failure. Thank you, sir, in the back. Okay? So this goes back to the topic of descriptive naming, right? In your production code, you may, for performance reasons, you may be like, well, I don't want a method that's named, you know, company entity with three users and 42 products, right, in my production code. Don't forget that this code doesn't run in production, right? And if it takes a couple extra minutes, even if it takes a whopping 5 minutes to run your suite, it can be worth it because it may take you 30 minutes to figure out what's going on. Make sense? Right? So descriptive naming is like really critically important. You should never be doing stuff like this. Never. This is a law. Okay? So use descriptive naming. Right? So user with company, user without company, right? And then it becomes really easy to figure out what the heck's going on, okay? Another principle, let's see what we got here. Okay, so another principle of controlling values with let is the argument of instance variables over lets, right? Raise your hand, how many of you use instance variables in place of lets? Sometimes. You say sometimes, do you have a reason why?
What happened at the time?
Okay.
I guess because it's an older style, but I mean, I know you can use let there.
Mm-hmm.
Also, visually, sometimes I find that.
Sure. Yeah, a lot of editors, right? Like, let's look at this here for a second, right? Like, I'm using Sublime, for example, right? And in this example, right, how do I know that this is that and this, right? But if I was to put in an instance, well, I guess in my editor I've turned it off, but, right. For most editors or IDEs, they'll have, you know, like a different type of highlighting. So absolutely, right? So here's an argument. Does... This is the argument for why. Go ahead. Yeah, so what I would say is there's actually a smell in the code in terms of your assertions. And in terms of your tests, because there's a few big values to a let, okay? And here's a couple of examples. So let's say, for example, we're going to jump down. Let's describe for a moment our full name method, okay? So full name, now again, if we were TDDing this, we would approach this a little differently, but just for the sake of example, we'll keep it like it is, right? What our expectation is going to be that we have got three different attributes that we're going to concatenate together. We've got a first name, a middle name, and a last name. We're going to concatenate them together, and we're going to put a space between the words, right? Pretty straightforward and simple. Now, you may be asking yourself, well, geez, Mr. Cuppy, why would you write it like this, right, and not like just simply doing, you know, this, right? Well, the reason is because in our code, we have optional values, right? So what's going to happen is, for middle name as an example, it could be nil, right? So the concatenation, so this array, this method on the array compact, is going to remove the nil values from the array, and it's just going to make an array of values. Then I'm going to join them together. So if I have a first name, no middle name, and a last name, the full name is going to be first and last. If I have a middle name and a last name, it's not going to have first, so on and so forth, right? So we have... Anybody know how to do the math? How many permutations do we have with just these three values?
2 to the 3.
How many?
8.
Right? Or is it 6?
2 to the 3rd.
2 to the 3rd. That's right. Right. Okay, so. That's right. That's actually a good point. That's actually a good point, right? So we have, but setting that aside, like in terms of, let's say the validations are gone, right? We have a lot of different permutations. We have a lot of different possibilities here. Testing that becomes hell.
Well, actually, you have to test the permutations.
Right.
To make sure the validations are working, right? That's what you're saying.
Right.
So, like, there are a lot of permutations, even though only two of them are valid.
That's right. That's right. So... So testing this is going to be kind of is going to inherently be a little bit of a nightmare, right? Potentially, if we want to give it like really solid coverage. Now, again, arguably, you know, we don't need to do all this testing and all that stuff. And I get that. But setting that aside for a moment, like if we wanted to be super rigid about it, we've got a lot of variations in here that need to be tested, and we've got a little bit of issue. Now, here's going back to the topic of lets over instance variables. Okay. How many of you have seen something like this happen? So we're going to describe our full name. Okay. And we're going to say when all name, when first name, middle name, and last name exist. Okay. So we're talking from a minimum valid object. So what's the only thing we have to add? There you go. Right? We already know this to be true. Okay. We're minimum valid, so we know that to be the case. All right. So now what we're going to do is we're going to say actually. As an example, I need to do it this way. So this is what generally will happen.
The man with three first names.
The man with three. I am Tri-J. And then, of course, I've got to bind these values into my user object. So I'm going to say user first name is first name. Okay. I did what? I did what? I'm sorry, what did I do?
Line 24.
So what's going to fail about this?
You're going to have really strong muscles.
Out. Oh, just kidding. So, I'm sorry, what did I do wrong? Has anyone ever spelled an instance variable wrong in their life?
Never.
Right? How easy would it be to overlook this? Right? So let's say, for example, right? Okay, so we're like, okay, so I need to make sure that this is running. So let's run our test here real quick. So we're going to do full name on line 14. Nope. I really need to set up some alias. Not RP. 14, isn't that right? 14. What?
RC from the back.
Oh, okay. I'll clear it. Yeah. Wait, what a second. Wait, hold on. I expected all three. I didn't get all three. Okay, I got to look at my code. Nope. This is all fine. Ah, I know what I need to do. Binding dot pry. Okay. Okay. No. Okay. I don't need to do that. Yeah, this test is pointless. Okay, I'm good. Okay, so what did I do wrong? Oh, there we go. Okay, so just for...
Did the response give any indication?
Yeah, it told me it failed. Right? I mean, like, all it's... Right, it's just saying, oh, I've got issues. Okay, well, I'm going to go hunt through the code. At this point in time, I've got a callus right about here from beating against the wall. And I'm pretty positive that I should put in a letter of resignation here soon. Because I obviously can't figure this out. For this example, all I'm going to do is replace these temporarily with this, right? Just so that you can see the example. We'll run it again, and we'll see what we get. A little bit more informative, shall we? Okay. Anybody know why? Because let is generates a what?
Method.
A method versus an instance variable when spelled incorrectly outputs what?
Nil.
Nil. There's a great few talks on the death of nil and how much we want to kill that. But here's a perfect example, right? Undefined variable or method last name. So where am I going to look? In one spot, right? So this is an this is part of the argument towards the value of let, is that because it's creating a method itself, when you spell it wrong, it's going to say no method error, right? Or undefined method, right? So this is part of that value, right? But then the other thing is speaking to instance variables, is you can do similar things because in reality, all a let is actually doing is something, I mean, it's a little bit more complicated than this, but effectively, we'll say value. It's doing this. That's essentially all that's happening, right? Is it's creating a method, and then it's doing an instance variable cache of a value, right? So you can call that value. So just like a method on an object, you can overwrite these just through inheritance, effectively. This is essentially the same sort of convention. So this is why this works. So control all of your values with let, right? The other and avoid using instance variables altogether, right? Might be a little bit more challenging to read, but this is why it can be hugely beneficial towards that whole developer happiness thing, right? So just for the sake of example, and actually, that's not what I'm going to do. Which object we're talking about. When I said all values, you have seen something like that. How many of you is be descriptive? This. And that is. Fourteen still. Never mind. Pry. What did I do? Oh. Good man. Where are we? Now let's find out what to do. There we go. You can do that. However, one of the downsides can be that if you're, and this would just be a pattern you can choose based on your actual implementation. But let's say, for example, up here in the model, it's going to return. So let's say you write in some code that says that if middle name, for example, is blank, I want a default. Now you have a failure again, right? So in this example, what I'm going to do is I want to say I want to explicitly set middle name to be this value. I don't want there to be any question as to what's going to happen. And so I'm going to force that to be true. But both work, right? I mean, actually, I would say that more often than not, I actually do what you're saying, and I would do something along this line. Middle name, I would say middle name. And I might even do this, and I would do this in this case. Okay? So that I
see.
Yeah. So now I'm going to override the value, but the default can be nil.
And then you just cut that block. So you
don't yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that cuts out the
default. Yeah. Sorry. So, and then it cuts this guy out. Yeah, exactly. Yes, sir? Should you, so again, the question is should you calculate the value or should you? Okay, so what's the expectation from a user's perspective? The calculate or the actual string? So here's the deal is, if you have to test your test, we got some challenge. Like if I'm like, oh yeah, I wouldn't write this like this, this is lame-o. What I'm going to do is, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my first name, and then I'm going to take my middle name, and then actually I'm going to take my last name here. And then what I'm going to do is, oh, yeah, that's right, I'm going to compact these, and then I'm going to join them together, okay, and this should be the value that I get, right? Right? Because I'm going to use this code to test that code. Which makes total sense. Yes?
Why did you spell out the literal in the application?
Down here?
Yeah, right here. Yeah.
Why did I use full name here?
No, yeah, instead of the what do you expect?
Because I control all my values with what? All of them.
That's a lot.
Yes? A lot of extra code? Sure, absolutely. You're going to add lines, but here's the deal is now, let's say for example, I now add more assertions to this, and this is going to continue down the path, but this won't change. I don't have to go through and change any of those values. Right? I'm saying here, basically, my let is setting up my core expectation, my core state of the object. Because I am saying that middle name will be this, first name will be this, our full name is going to expect to be this, and now all of my assertions are going to run against that. So whenever I need, so in my code, if I'm like, oh, I'm changing the way full name is working. So now my expectations, so let's say, here's an example. So now I'm going to say it, I could put this in a context, but for the sake of example, I'll just put it inside the it here. I'm going to say it truncates characters over 10, right? So now what I can do, this is one I would put in a context. Here we go. Whatever it would be.
Set that again?
Yeah, because it's going to be over 10. So, let's see here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, that was dumb. Is that 10? 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. Okay. So by controlling it all, by controlling everything through all of the values through lets, all my expectations are run the same, right? All I have to do is I have to work through a common convention that this is going to be where the value gets controlled. So if down in my nesting of the examples, right, if down through here I begin to mutate full name to see what the expectation is going to be at that point, then I'm still working through a common convention, right? But if down here I start to actually pass values in, which makes a lot of sense, it makes a ton of sense, then it's very likely, and this is actually what happens to me, is I miss I miss these expectations, right? So I will use this pattern controlling everything through let to be able to allow that to be true, right? Yes, sir.
Now, what if for some reason we decided to make the first name optional? Then our full name test would break, right?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. But that's, so if you're taking a TDD approach, you're gonna alter your test first. Right, so I'm going to go through and I'm going to say, well, everywhere in which I'm using this now needs to be modified because the expectation has now changed, right? Or if nothing else, let's say that we run that scenario. So I'm going to go through and I'm going to test it and I'm going to go, oh, these tests break, right? Now myself as a developer goes, whoa, that's actually the implications of a change like that. Do I actually want that to be true? Do I want that to be changing also? Right? Any other questions? Does that answer your question?
Yeah, but maybe from another standpoint, if you look at that test in isolation, you see that middle name is been assigned, but you have to know in order to understand this test that full name, first name and last name are required for the minimum valid object. So
you would change it in the initial setup of the minimum variable or viable, right? Minimum valid. So you'd go up and you would maybe set first name to nil if a valid first name is nil, right?
Yeah, but the weird thing is now you have a context which says when first name, middle name, and last name exist, that's not actually stated specifically. That's a context that now no longer exists unless you definitely keep your user exactly the same forever.
Yeah.
Which is a part of the chaoticness that I guess, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a really good point and a good catch. And that's part of the challenge of actually structuring the tests or the specs in when you're passing in really descriptive blocks like this. Like oftentimes I will eliminate the description of the it and go straight to the expectation because RSpec will format that for me. Sometimes it's descriptive enough, other times it's not. So it becomes something that's left to the individual to decide, and which actually kind of goes back to your point a little earlier about should I include detail, should I not? This is a prime example of where including the detail is actually working against me a little bit, right? So, yeah, but good point, good questions, and good things to point out. Any other, yeah?
I have a question about something different that you might want to answer in a different part of the presentation, but, so my understanding of the current RSpec convention is that copy bar tests now go in feature specs, mm-hmm. And so it seems then that there's some redundancy between the request specs and the controller specs, mm-hmm. And I'm wondering what each are supposed to be used for.
Yeah, so that's going to be outside of this. So his question is now the convention when it comes to the use of capybara specifically with your request or your integration tests is that they're going to be encapsulated into feature specs. So instead of describe, you're using feature, and then instead of it, you're using scenario, right? And then he's also talking about with request specs. Which, you know, as an example, you might be using a request spec to test an API where you're actually hitting an endpoint and asserting the values that it's returning. And so when do you use one or the other and how do you dry that up? Is that kind of what you're
more between the controller and the request specs, because those are both the controller.
Yeah. So it's going to be a little outside of this workshop, but at the end of it, I can totally circle back around with you. Okay. So the next, just to kind of, I'm going to move on from there. The next thing that we're going to talk about is this guy, and that is extracting common behaviors. So we're now getting to the point where, again, if we look at our code, We're getting to the point where we're running the same expectation over and over again, right? We see that? So our code's not dry anymore, right? And if we change one, now I got to change the others, right? So then we're going to extract a common behavior, right? Or a common behavior and a common expectation. How many of you have you worked with shared examples before? Okay, cool. So how many of you have absolutely no idea what I'm talking about? Just in gen, okay, how, keep your hand up if it, that's an in general. Like, I have no idea what you're talking about in general. Okay, good. No, this is gonna be fine. This is gonna be fine, here we go. So a shared example is very similar to a mixin in Ruby, okay? It functions in a very similar capacity. In other words, a shared example is you are going to encapsulate a set of expectations and as a behavior, right? So let's say, for example, just to make a simple example here, I am going to, so we start with this code right here, right? So there's a single expectation that's really common, and it's that I expect the user to be invalid in this state, right? Okay. So what we're going to do is I'm going to start by cleaning this up. But now let's say, for example, that we are going to add additional expectations of things that are considered invalid, right? So again, we talked about errors, but let's say, for example, we want to test that everything's working and that there are errors present, right? And so now if we want this, if we want to be running this test or this expectation with all of the invalids, now we've got to do this. Call in spotlight to fix my issues, right? So we're going to have this go over and over and over again, right? So we're in making our code cleaner, we're actually making it less clean, right? So what we can do is we can use shared examples to encapsulate these two expectations into one common behavior. We're going to say that effectively in this state, the object is invalid. How we test for its validity is we say that we run the invalid method on it, it will be invalid, and we want to know that errors are present, right? So a shared example is what facilitates that. Now, there are a bunch of different ways that you can implement a shared example, right? One of them is that shared examples can be scoped to the describe that it is encapsulated in, or the context, right? The example, right? So I could come here and I could say, well, I have a shared example. Right, and in my shared example, all I'm going to do is I'm going to take this. Okay. Bind it to the subject. That's not what I wanted to do. Okay. And so now I can actually replace. What did I
say? Subject.
Well found, friend. Well found. And so now I can actually replace all of these with it should behave like.
While you're doing that, why did we have to go back to subject in that context? We were still within the upper describe that had the left user.
Yeah, so So I went back to it mostly because this becomes evaluated in the context of the explain, right? So the reason why I go back and I will replace these with subject is simply because the subject in the context of this shared example may be changing, right? Because I can use these elsewhere. I can actually start to say, I want this subject to be some other entity, right? So, but I'll answer this a little bit more detail here in a second. Okay. So a shared example is simply a way to encapsulate common expectations and bind it to some sort of explanation, right? So as an example right here, I'm going to say, okay, now I can take my two lines of code and I can bring it down to one. And I can say it should behave like an invalid user, right? Does that make sense? Right? To dry it up.
Well, so follow up to this question.
would you change the last name as well? Because you had user in there, like, I explicitly think that my release is going to change the subject, but I'm going to leave the last name. Yeah. User as well.
Where are you looking?
An invalid user.
Here? Yeah.
No. Yeah, exactly.
And you're looking at where? I'm sorry.
You changed the identification on user to be subject because you thought you might reuse it, but you're still basically asserting that your example is a user.
Yeah, totally. So here's what I will do. Here's actually what I do with my shared examples. I actually move them out to new files. Okay. So how many of you have used Cucumber specifically, Cucumber and Capybara to do like integration tests or anything like that? Okay. So in Cucumber, you're going to write basically a declarative process through which to test or assert something, right? And then you have step definitions that define in an imperative fashion in more detail how this is going to be run or done, right? Shared examples I treat in a very similar fashion, right? What I do is with my shared examples, I'll create a new file that is the shared example. Known as specs, support, create a new folder called shared examples. We'll call these say again. Yeah, we can do that. Okay. Now I can pull this out. Okay. So basically, all that happens is I'm moving this into its own directory that is shared examples, right? Which is more of an imperative format to. To running these collection of expectations, okay? So now what happens is that in this context, right, in the context of using the shared example, I can actually replace this, okay? Should behave like an invalid object, right? So now what I can do is I can now use this shared example for things that all they do is they have an invalid method on them or a valid method on them, right? And it can be taken outside of just active record, right? So what I'm doing is I'm making my code more usable is basically what's happening. Do both methods work? Yes. And it's really up to you to decide in terms of whether or not you're going to call it a subject or you're going to call it user or how you're going to interact with them. My personal preference is I like the separation a lot. Like I like to pull them and take them apart. Okay. Yes, you can. Very good. Okay. Can you pass in arguments to it, right? So here's another way to continue to dry this up a little bit. Okay, so we're actually going to come down here. We're going to use this guy. So this is actually in the spec helper. This line. Okay, so it's including everything in support, right? Now, again, you know, this is all automatic. So when you're installing RSpec from the very first time and you run the generator for RSpec install, it's including the spec helper, and this line is in there, right? So the assumption is, the convention is that anything like this is going to be under the spec or the support directory. So spec and support, and it will load all of those files. Okay, so yes, to answer your question, it is included by default, okay? So these behaviors here can take values into them. So
Let's
Yeah. Absolutely.
So it feels a little overkill, but
So his comment is that this feels a little overkill because this is a very simplistic example, and that's very much the case. Let's see. Let me show an example. Let me show you what I was looking at. This is one I was working on. So if you can see, here is an example. This is from CanCan. Okay, where there's more complexity that's baked into here and our expectations are fairly common, right? Like, as an example, we're asserting against, that's, okay, now we're gonna open Xcode, that's no good. Shh, quiet time, Xcode. Yes, ignore you, okay. Let's see. Okay. So here's an example from CanCan. Okay, and this is a really common situation, okay, is that, again, we see a lot of stuff. Again, this code runs, right? It all runs. The expectations do go green. But what we can see is we can see things like we've got instance variable usage. We've got a lot of common expectations that are being duplicated over and over again. This would be a perfect use case, a prime candidate for the use of a shared example, right? Because in this situation, we could clean up this code a lot. And tell me, other than through the description, is it very readable? Is it easy to understand what's going on without your programmer brain on? Not really, right? It's a little challenging, right? So in terms of developer happiness, we're kind of throwing it out the window just a touch, right? But I mean, don't, I'm not criticizing CanCan. It's a solid, awesome product, okay? But what we can do with these shared examples is we can start to encapsulate even more of our functionality, right? So let's look at, where's a good example?
Question?
Yeah.
When an expectation that you back it out in a shared example fails, what line number does it give you back?
Gives you back a shared example. In the back trace of the spec failure, it'll give you both, actually. It'll tell you. Yeah, it'll give you both. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So let's do.
Really, if you only have a one-line expectation and it's repeated, the real issue here is not being tried. The real issue is to be readable.
The concern is, it's actually the concern of both, right? It's dry and readable.
Well, either way, you're not.
Well, in this example, it's two lines with one line.
Right, right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So in the can, yeah, exactly.
The real benefit is a couple of months down the road when you're like, oh, you know what? I want to add one. You think, oh, I can add it in one spot.
For sure.
Exactly.
For sure.
Exactly. Let me see. Okay, so here's an example. A good thing I kind of loosely put this together. So I'm going to show just kind of a brief example where we can encapsulate a ton of functionality and leave this really pretty darn clean. Okay. So here's a scenario that I put together myself, right? That's it? Yeah. So the spec looks like this at the end. Okay?
So this is all the full name functionality, the permissions, and it behaves like the user. All of the behavior is wrapped up in that. So shared examples can be incredibly powerful because what it allows us to do is it allows us to define in a declarative fashion what the behavior of the object should be. So now when I go through this, like again, we're talking about permutation. Like I can say, oh, it behaves, so full name, it behaves like a full name with first name, middle name, last name. And I'm like, oh, well, actually now I also want to add in here, I want the version where it's going to behave like that with middle name and last name. And I'm done. Right? Does that make sense? Right? So behaviors, shared examples can be insanely powerful to really help support this. Now, what this information, here's the end, and here I'll show you.
Quick question. Those variables you have
The let's first, yeah. Mm-hmm. So here are these shared examples. I would break into individual files. So I'm going to say that I would not be putting these at the top of the file, but for the sake of explanation, that's where they are. So this is a shared example for user, okay? And you don't have to put it pass in a string. You can also pass in an object or some sort of entity, right? And I'm doing all of this setup in one spot, right? All of it in one location, right? But these down here, this information gets passed along to the example itself, and it comes through as variables in the block with options. Does that make sense? So it's just like normal code, right? This is all Ruby. At the end of the day, that's all this is Ruby, right? But what this is allowing me to do is it's allowing me to set up what the common implementation is from a from an expectation level, right? Like the user, by and large, is going to have these attributes. It's going to have these core expectations, these permutations, so on and so forth. What the only thing I'm going to be manipulating is values, ultimately, right? I'm going to say that in the scenario where first name and last name exists, all of this stays true, right? But it still should behave like a valid user, right? Or should still behave like user, right? And I can do the same thing with my full name, too. So again, I would put this in a different example. Now, the only thing that I would caution against is, and I kind of stopped in my example, but is that there is a decent amount of logic that's happening right here. I would caution away from this. I mean, if I, continuing down this path, if I was to continue to implement this, I would work to eliminate as much of this logic as possible. But ultimately, you get the idea that this is a way for us to use Ruby as a language to program our specs in very simplistic terms so that we can come up with ultimately something that's very, very easy to work with. Very, very easy to work with. Does that make sense? Right? Any questions about that component to it? Yes, sir.
So you're passing in an array, but it seems like you're handling it like a hash on the other side. Is that?
Let me see. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. That's my mistake here. So you can... I think my example was incomplete. My apologies. Yeah, so you caught that. I'm calling this because of the question, so I apologize if it's confusing. But the fundamental component to it is this, that with a shared example, what it's going to allow you to do is the first, this component, it behaves like, so there's it should behave like, and then there's it behaves like, there you go, the alias to the same spot. Is going to be your declaration of behavior. Beyond that point, you can pass it metadata and actual values. You can do both, right? And those values now present themselves inside the behavior, right? So you can use those values to do whatever you need to do.
Let me see if I can find. Another thing that you could do with this is you could actually pass them in as lets. So in the example here, so I'll say it behaves like a full name. With, and I can say let first name be, okay.
And what this will do is it will utilize these lets in the context of this shared example. Right? So here would be another argument for why an instance variable would be a pain in the rear, because you can't actually pass it in very easily. Right? So this these examples up top are the use of the metadata that you can pass in. Other things that you can do is that you could pass in admin true, for example. So you could say, I'm going to set up this entire very large scenario where it's testing the full name, it's testing permissions, it's testing the user validity, it's testing all these things. The only thing that is changing is that now it's an admin, right? So I can say it behaves like full name with, or it behaves like user where the name is Bob, and then below it I'm gonna say it behaves like user where admin is true. And just like that, it's done, right? All of my behavior is encapsulated inside of this effective mixin, is essentially what's happening. And I can now use that to manipulate this. Now again, as a developer,
I mean, tell me, be honest, like if you were to come to this and you were to look at it this way, is this a little bit more understandable as to what's going on, how, and why? Right? I mean, there's more to it, don't get me wrong, and your tests are going to, and as you're structuring your tests, there's more and more to this that's going to happen. But the bottom line is that this is a way, this is the pattern that you can use to really dry up and make this more behavior and declarative than imperative inside of your specs themselves. Okay? So we are, in terms of time-wise, we are about 11:45. So here's what I want to do is I can answer any questions, but then because it's kind of in the workshop fashion is, in terms of shared examples, there's a lot of great, everything that I went over here in terms of documentation on how to use RSpec is, there's ample, it's all over the internet. But what I'd like to do is like open it up in terms of being able to walk through examples and be able to code some of, wire some of this stuff up.
Because shared examples as an example can be, I can walk through exactly how this works if that would help. But I want to
just leave it to, in terms of the experience of the room, what you guys want to do. Yeah.
I do have a question on the shared examples.
Sure.
Going back to an earlier comment you had on tests for your tests, do you have any guidelines or laws on when it's too much in the shared example? You know, because now you're passing in values.
Yeah. So, like I was saying, like this is a, this block, this kind of chunk right here from lines 28 through 43. Ow. This would be a scenario where I would be very cautious, right? Like I would go, okay. How much faith do I have as a developer that this is going to function as I expect, right? That's the boundary, right? Because what I don't want to do is I never want to get to a point where I'm actually testing tests, which I've actually watched done.
Oh.
Truly, right? Like I've seen it done, and they're like, well, no, I mean, because it's all Ruby and I want my Ruby code to be super sweet. And it's like, ooh, it's great. And so, you know, I'm going to have, I've seen this too. This is the craziest one. I've seen people create classes that respond to call, the method call, and so they can pass it in the form of a block as the example.
Right? Here's what I mean. It's a wild thing. So basically replacing this with what would be the equivalent of and then they're removing all of this.
Right? Does that make sense? See what's going on. It's just, it's instead of actually using the behavior of the block in this context, I'm actually going to encapsulate it in its own code. So that all sounds fine and dandy. Like, if you want to make your code super dry, you're like, well, yeah, of course you're going to do that, right? Because I'm a Ruby ninja. But the reality is now I have this entity here that's not actually tested anymore. Right? And so how do I know the block's working like it should work? How do I know that that I'm passing in like in the context of RSpec properly so that it works, right? So it's really easy to go way too far down the rabbit hole with this stuff.
So what I would say is there is a boundary. Ultimately, my preference is to get the code to a point where
I can identify clearly what permutations are being tested and what ultimately is the variable in there, the variable entity, right? Admin, first name, middle name, last name. And actually to your question about
this, so this is actually first name. So this is an example of using it to come through the names parameter. Right? Okay. So, in my example, I may have a situation where I am going to, you know, there's all this setup, right?
I mean, there's all of this that's happening ultimately to run that, right? So, this is a way for me to kind of help support that cause, right? Does that make sense? Yes? Questions?
Is there an analog to shared examples for setting up state where in a more flexible way than a for block, you want to do it more selectively?
Like as a
constant scopes.
So ask that again, if you have a scenario.
So let's say there's a particular execution path in Capybara where you want a bunch of links in order. There's specific places that you want to use that particular sequence. But because it's a cross-scopes or something, it's just a little bit of a block and have a run for everything.
Yeah, so another common practice would be to actually create helper methods. Yeah. So the next layer to this that you could use is, you know, again, we have, so his question is fundamentally that what if you have like a common runtime order, right? Like you have some setup, but it's not really set up in terms of a before, right? Like, but what you're doing is you're like, in his example, he's bringing up like Capybara and a feature test where you're, you know, stepping through links on a page, or you're, you know, I'm visiting this URL and I'm visiting this and I'm visiting this and I'm posting this and visiting this and visiting this, and that's happening every single time. Granted, your feature's going to run crazy slow, but you know, but say that's what you're trying to do, is you're trying to make that a common sequence. You can use helper methods to do it, and a helper method is like any other method. You're going to define, you can define it a multitude of different ways. But let's do this. So we'll just include our spec helper for a second. Just for this example, we'll use a describe here, and we'll say we can use a feature. That's fine. Feature. Authenticating. Okay. And my scenario is when the okay. So in this example, we're going to have, you know, we're going to visit the login URL, and we're going to fill in, let's say, email with sample.com, and we're going to fill out. Dang it, I did it again. Just kidding. You guys are getting bored of my humor, I can tell. Okay. I think it's click on, isn't that right? Submit. I always forget. Okay. So, and then we're going to say that page, isn't it, is it current page? Is that right? I think this is right. Or it's current path. To equal okay. So in this example, like, so we might have this code right here that we want to run over and over and over again, right? Again, it's going to be slow, but setting that aside, let's say we want to run this over and over and over again.
Sorry.
Yeah, rock that. I was like, okay. So you can create helper methods to support this, and a helper method, all it is a method, right? So you're going to say login with valid credentials, right? And then we're going okay. Oh, and then there we go. It's visible in that scope and anything that cascades down.
Yeah.
Okay. Any sub. Right. So there's two ways to do this. One is you could actually declare a method. Now, but here's the downside is if you get into the habit of doing this a lot, now you've got all of these methods that are being defined, right? And they're just like, here's another one, you know, and here's another one, and here's another one. So RSpec has got a really great simple tool for that, and that is that you can actually mix in helpers, okay? as micros or macros, right? So you can actually mix in, just like you would a module mix in for Ruby, you can do the same with class and instance variable type stuff. So these would be considered, these are going to be put on within the context of this example object, which is the RSpec example object, right? But let's say, for example, that what I want to do is I want to create an even more complex scenario where I want to pass in specific values, like, for example, right? So now what I want to do is I'm now going to do where username is this and password is that, right? And I'm going to replace username and password, right? And now I'm going to use it down here. Breaking rules, here we go. Right? And I'm going to use those credentials. I can pass it around like a method. Okay? But what RSpec has, which is really awesome, is that you can actually define helpers, right? So you could say that Ruby, I'll do a module that is authentication helper, right? And I can do just like I would if I have just like I would in a mix-in for in Rails or anything that's using that has access to active support concern. I can also say, or not class, module class methods, right? And I can define a authenticate with credentials. I could have that. Then I can also just, again, this is all active support concerns, just like a normal module. So I could say move this code here. Okay? Right, so again, still a mix-in. Then in my spec helper, I just include it. Right, so I'm going to take this guy and I will put it in support. Yeah, so again, like if you've got, so here's what I did. I moved through a little quickly. So inside the spec directory, I created a new subdirectory called helpers. And again, as a reminder, this won't work. I screwed this up. Hold on 1 second. This needs to be under the support directory. Yep. There we go. So inside of spec support, I created a new directory that's helpers, and then I just simply created, like I would anything else, I created an authentication module, authentication helper module, right? Just like you would helpers inside of, like your application controller or controller helpers. I just extended active support concern like I would that module, and active support concern gives me access, or convention-wise, watches for class methods being declared inside of another submodule. And then instance methods are those that are within the scope of the helper itself. And then, so that's one part of it. So again, a module like anything else. I've just said that about 47 times. But then in my spec helper, and you'll notice that this is, and here we'll pull some of this out. Just fixtures, die. Okay. So then at the bottom here, I just include what helpers I want to, config include helpers. All of this is documented through RSpec core. So none of this is, like the Adam Cuppy school of thought.
Sorry, did you put that line somewhere else? Or there was another file I saw that at the bottom.
This one? Oh, sorry. I just removed all the commented code.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, no. Okay. So this is a way to, again, encapsulate, dry up everything. So at the end of the day, the core belief that I have is that your specs should be your features, your specs, your tests. You can also do this all through mini test as well. Like, this isn't just an RSpec convention, can be used to really dry up a lot of things. And encapsulating your logic that ultimately is very imperative, like it's a step-by-step procedural thing, I work to encapsulate that inside of modules and helpers. And then in a declarative fashion, I will call on behaviors and use shared examples to declare a behavior, right? It behaves like a full name with this, right? That's my declarative example. Now I can go back into my shared example whenever I want these expectations to be changing. I can go back to it and say, well, what defines a full name now? What defines that behavior is step A, B, C, or D, right? And all of these now still hold as true, right? In terms of they stay in the code that way. Does that make sense?
Did you show using that authenticate anywhere?
I didn't. And the only reason why I didn't is because I didn't have any of the routes or anything like that set up. The authenticate anywhere, the mixin?
Yeah.
This guy right here? Or which one are you?
I have a comment and a couple of questions.
Please.
One is, why did you need to get into the active support concerns? Like, I've used helpers for logging in, and actually that's my comment, which is that's not the whole story, because where you're in a test environment, there will be no user to validate against, so we often end up using stubs to be able to actually log in and fake out the authentication, because we're not testing authentication, we're testing the
dashboard.
And I am sure I don't remember needing to get into the whole active concerns there. So what did that
So active support concern as a library
right.
is just helping the module mix-in process. That's it. So I could replace this.
I don't remember using it, and it worked, so that's why I'm kind of curious.
What it's for?
What am I missing out on by not having it?
Active support concern applies more convention to handling modules and specifically, or not modules, but mix-ins and modules into other Ruby objects. Right, classes. So
that's why I'm wondering how you use this, because we just use it as a helper, and RSpec finds it no problem and does what I want it to do as far as the helper.
You only need it to be using the class.
Right. Yeah. Sorry. So yes. So if all I was doing was this,
right.
I wouldn't have to use, I'm sorry, to kind of make that a little bit more confusing. That's right. So because I'm creating a class method entity here, I'm using active support concern to utilize the convention of a module, submodule called class methods, which it's going to help with that, right? So in the example, maybe to clean it up and make it a little bit more clear, it would look like this, right? Yeah, sorry. So I'm just, it was more to kind of answer and address his question. So, like, that would be its use, right? Does that answer your question a little bit? Okay.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, one brief comment. The nested format is absolutely great. As of RSpec, it's analogous to the documentation format, which you're getting rid of all the A's, and sometimes there's going to be a ton of mess. So in the future, if nested stops working, documentation is
working. Good point. Yeah, absolutely. So RSpec 3, if you could hear, could everybody hear what he was saying?
No.
Okay, so RSpec 3, they're changing some of the the ways in which you can use formatters. And in the examples I was using, I was, you know, running the test and I was passing in tac format space nested, right? And that was to use the nested format so that we could see that. In RSpec 3, they're effectively going to be deprecating a lot of that. And what you're going to be using instead is, what's it called? It's doc?
Documentation.
Yeah, okay, it's just the documentation. I thought it had a different, it's like a short
Which method. Nested is an alias, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so documentation format. So just as an example, that's going to come along. What I would say is everything, again, everything that I've talked about here, the RSpec documentation through relishapp.com is actually pretty strong. However, there's some weird linking issues, like, you know, you could be looking for one version of the documentation and it's hard to find the other, but it's actually really good, and I'll bring it up here real quick so we can see it. Let's see, RSpec. There we go. Internets, are you alive today? Talk to me, interwebs.
Go next door. Hold the next door. Wi-Fi.
Next door. This one? Ooh.
There's only like six people in there using it.
That's nice. Okay.
There were six people. Now they're going to be
talking. Yeah. I feel like Steve Jobs having you guys to telling you guys to turn off Wi-Fi so my iPhone will work.
Can I check what the specs for the expectation format would be for shared examples? Would we expect something to behave like?
No, so the expect syntax hasn't changed at all. It's still the same. It's just it should behave like such and such because it's encapsulating other expectations.
Okay, but that's within the block, right? But
it's within the block.
The actual assertion.
In the example itself.
Yeah.
So in the example itself, it's exactly the same.
How would you use that in the expect
syntax? You don't use it. Because this is not, so this is not an expectation or an assertion itself. This is an encapsulation of behavior. So all this is doing is this is just a convention of calling the collection that is the shared example.
So I've got a long series of long features that I want to say for a different set of users. And so you do it in a shared example. Would you break the shared example down inside shared examples? Does that work?
You definitely can. The question is can you effectively nest shared examples? Right, so I'm gonna put a shared example in another shared example. And the answer is that you can to a certain extent, but I don't really recommend it. And the only reason is because the function of a shared example is to encapsulate the imperative style of your expectations. In other words, like it's to encapsulate your expectations, right? These are the five things that need to be true, false, whatever, right? Okay. And so it needs to be used in that context. When you start to nest, like continue to nest, not only does it become harder to track, like when I look at this behavior, for example, when I read it, my sense is that it's testing full name. That's what it's testing. But if it's also, I've actually thrown in shared examples that are now going to test first name too, right? So I've got the shared example for it should behave like a first name with this, and it should behave like a middle name, it should behave like a last name. When I read this spec, it's hard to know all of that's happening. Things are going to start to fail potentially, but from a developer happiness standpoint, there's that. So I would actually break them up and keep them as shallow as is reasonable, right? Does that answer your question?
So then how would you do a long-running feature test?
So I would split it up into shared examples, but it would be a combination of shared examples and helpers, right? So what I would do is I could use, I would break it up into shared examples and keep them as collections, right? I mean, this shared examples folder might get larger. Well, it's going to get larger, right? And I might have a dozen different files in there, two dozen files in there that represent the different types of shared examples that I would be using. But that's perfectly okay because those aren't the things that are my te- those aren't the things that I'm looking through for my tests themselves, right? I've got a set of specs over here that I'm trying to read and understand the conventions that are being used, okay? But the separation of my shared examples are there. Then in my helpers, I'm going to start to identify what things, what common functions need to be utilized to either set up the scenario that I'm trying to run or trying to, you know, or things that I may need to persist over time, right? So it's going to be a combination of the two, right? But really, ultimately, what its structure ends up looking like is it looks like a Rails app, right? You've got models, right? You have controllers, and then you have, you know, some view layer. I mean, like, you've got these components, you have helpers, you know, like, you have these components that are all broken out, but, like, looking at a controller, which really is the spec, right? I mean, like, I'm looking at the spec, and ultimately, what it's doing is it's showing me a control-type function, right? In a way, in a roundabout sort of way, right? So this would be the equivalent of my controller, and just like a good pattern when writing code in a controller is you keep them as fairly slim. Like, you don't want to just throw a ton of logic in your controller actions, for the same reasons, right? We want to illustrate the kind of core behaviors that are occurring. What is the ins and outs, and where does it need to go? That help?
Yeah.
Great. So we're just about time. So I just want to, again, like that we've talked a lot, I want to just kind of summarize these components just so it's clear. So one of the things, the big things we talked about was controlling your values using lets. You can do this, again, your lets, they cascade, so they bubble up the chain. And so because of that, you can, you know, declare first name, last name, all of that stuff, and then in a later context, you can mutate that, and it's going to bubble up the chain in a way that, you know, allows you to assert values. Instance variables, if you spell them wrong, then all you get back is nil, versus if you spell a let incorrectly in terms of its usage, you'll get a undefined method error. So that is controlling your values with let. Descriptive naming, again, what we talked about is this is death, right? Because, again, if we run our expectations and we have a failure, when I'm trying to read it, it doesn't really make any sense, right? I don't get a strong sense of what is going on. However, if I change the naming convention so it's fairly descriptive, the end result of that is going to be that when I have failures, I have a sense of what's going, I have a sense of, I have context, right? I have a sense of where the failure might be occurring in terms of differentiating itself from the other assertions that I'm also running, okay? This is probably the crux of it, in my opinion, is that if you want good, solid tests that are really easy to add to, extend, dry up, is that you start your test from a minimum valid object. Factory girl, this is the core convention of factory girl. Most people don't know that as a gem. And all factory girl does is it builds objects that you can interact with. So it's, you know, it's a mock of an object. But again, its core function is, its core usage that is that should be used as a minimum valid object that you then mutate, right? We looked at this a little bit, and this is kind of an argument for using should, but again, in terms of readability, and the ultimate kind of takeaway of this is that you should always be asserting to true, right? That's your goal, is assert to true, right? And in this example, it kind of makes sense. It feels like that is the case, right? Because I'm saying it should be true. But that's actually not what we're testing. What we're trying to test is that it's invalid, right? That's the truthy statement, is that this is an invalid entity, right? The other thing we talked about is permutations using context. So again, this goes back to lets. So ultimately what that means is that I can mutate the middle name, for example, and assert that things are still valid or invalid. I can assert to true. And then as these contexts begin to cascade and I nest them more and more, I can mutate the values inside these contexts with confidence that my expectation at this point in time, in this layer, is going to still work. It's going to work as I expect it to work. And this works in conjunction with a minimum valid object. These two go hand in hand. Extracting common behaviors. This is the use of shared examples. Something we didn't go into here because we kind of ran out of time, but is really, really powerful
is to create custom matchers. So as an example, this is a matcher right here. Be invalid is a matcher method. You can actually create your own. So I could encapsulate all of the logic. I'll show you just a very quick example. So here's an example of death, right? Has permission to edit the page. And I have all of this crazy logic that's being run inside to test, to extract a permission, to test against the permission. In fact, the way this test is broken out is I'm actually going to set a variable called RaiseError. Then I'm going to iterate through the permissions. I'm going to, if the edit state and the page match, then I want to raise an error, right? Invert this. Call true. Okay. And then it's going to raise the error, and I'm going to catch the error in the expectation and assert that it's not going to happen. That's basically this one of the dumber things that you can do. So what I could do instead is I could write a matcher for it. Right? So basically all I have to do is I say I expect user to have permission to edit page. Right? So this is another way to encapsulate a behavior, or at least the structure of the code, to allow you to create that. Again, all of this documentation is all on Relish app and RSpec, the RSpec core docs. So, you know, it's not any unique pattern or anything like that. Okay. And then declarative expectations. This also talks to the shared examples. So again, the declarative side of it is it behaves like, it should behave like this, right? Versus throwing all the expectations in there, right? So now what I can do is by having a declarative expectation, a behavior I'm speaking to, by doing that, then I can simply add kind of metadata to that explanation that's going to change it, right? So in this behavior, when admin is true, I want you to handle it this way and tell me if the full name still is how it should be formatted, right? So declarative expectations. Like I said a little earlier, if you guys don't know, our company Zeal puts on a workshop. It's an Agile TDD developers training and conference. We're going to be doing it on October 22nd through the 25th. Currently on roguerails.com, we are running basically a thing that if you add your email address, it's going to go away on Sunday. We're going to know you're from RailsConf, and so we're going to throw out a pretty smoking deal because we'd love to have you guys there. It'd be way cool. But ultimately what we go into, like Ryan Bates and Kent Beck, those guys were here last time. They helped organize the event with us. Ryan Bates, who does Railscasts, and Can. So those guys help organize. Kent Beck is one of the signatories of the Agile Manifesto, so test-driven development, all that stuff he's very into. So we put it on with them because we really want to train this stuff for the sake of developer happiness. So that's what Rogue Rails is. It's an event we run. Check out roguerails.com. Follow us on Twitter. It'd be great. Again, this is what I actually look like. That's actually a headshot of mine. But anyway, I really appreciate you guys coming down. I hope you feel like you got a lot out of this. I will post the slides. Check out the repository. I'll post notes there. I am at Adam Cuppy on Twitter. You can look up my name. I'm probably one of the only people that have the name of Adam Cuppy. But again, I really appreciate it. Thank you for your time. Hope you guys had a good RailsConf, and I probably will see you guys next year.